Oh, welcome to our afternoon technical sessions. The session we're in today is on future-focused research. What will we think of next? I'm Ray Furston, and I'm the director of the Office of Nuclear Regulatory Research, and I'm really excited to chair this session. I wanted to give you a brief history of future-focused research because it is a new program here at the NRC. It was supported by the commission in mid-FY20, and we got started on some projects in FY20. We were funded again in FY21, as well as FY22. And today you'll hear presentations and be able to ask questions of folks in the NRC that have been working on some of these projects throughout the year. So they'll be at different stages. Some were started in 20 and are finishing up, some in 21 and some in 22. And what I'm excited about at this program, this gives us a chance to look ahead, look beyond what we normally see in the Office of Research, where we're responding to user need requests from the business lines, which is very important. That's our bread and butter. That's what we should be doing. But this gives us a chance to get good ideas from not just staff in research, but throughout the agency on what should we be looking at with regard to new advanced technologies that have applications in nuclear, and what should we be doing as a regulator to get ready for those new technologies. So we're not the holdup when a licensee comes in and says, hey, I want to do this. And we say, well, we don't even seen that before. We're trying to stay at least even with the game or even ahead. And so the way that we're going to do the session is we'll have a presentation from each of the projects. We have five projects today, and I'll introduce the speaker and topic area. And then at the end of each presentation, we'll have a little bit of time for question and answers. Then we'll go to the next speaker, question and answers after that, and so on until we're finished with the session. So with that, I forgot. I also want to thank Jim Steckel. Jim, you did a great job organizing and coordinating everything. And of course, to all the speakers and those of you who have been working on our future-focused research projects. So with that, the first project I wanted to introduce is called Digital Twins, the Regulatory Viability. And I'm introducing not a speaker, but a team here. The digital project team is being led by our engineering branch in the Office of Research, and includes staff from across the agency, as well as some technical experts from the Idaho and Oak Ridge National Labs. And our reactor engineering branch plans and executes programs to develop technical bases, methods, and tools for advanced technology applications that influence the safety of operating and advanced reactors and other facilities we regulate. The Digital Twin Project was initiated in 2020 to study the potential nuclear domain applications of digital twin technology and the infrastructure needed to regulate such applications. The project wraps up this year with the publication of two final technical reports. And with that, I'll ask the technician to start the video slideshow, and then we'll conclude with some remarks from Dr. Iyengar.
Hello, and welcome to our Digital Twin Future Focus Research Project. My name is Jesse, and I'll be kicking things off today. So let's begin with a question. What exactly is a digital twin? Well, that's a great question. I'm glad you asked. For our project, we describe a digital twin as part of a nuclear digital twin system with four basic parts. The first part is the real world or physical plant. The physical plant includes all the plant structures, systems, and components, as well as associated physical phenomena, procedures, and even the human actions needed to safely produce nuclear power. The digital twin is the virtual representation of the physical plant. Depending on needs, a variety of plant systems can be twinned, from single components to an entire plant, and two categories of technologies are needed. Data and information management gives a digital twin the ability to gather, process, and disseminate data. And modeling and simulation makes that data useful through advanced technologies such as data analytics, artificial intelligence, and data-informed models. Of course, for the digital twin to maintain accuracy, otherwise known as state concurrence, it must constantly communicate with a physical plant. Real-time plant data and performance is transmitted to the digital twin to maintain this concurrence. The information is processed and returned to the physical plant as actions and recommendations, such as diagnostics, operational guidance, and even control signals. Together, these four parts form a nuclear digital twin system, enabling novel, real-time plant state awareness that can improve both plant efficiency and safety. More on the potential applications of a nuclear digital twin in the next segment.
Hi, my name is Angie Buford, and I'm the branch chief of the Reactor Vessels and Internals branch in the NRC's Office of Nuclear Reactor Regulation. Now let's briefly explore why there's so much interest in digital twins among nuclear stakeholders. From a stakeholder's point of view, digital twins can offer significant opportunities in design, testing, operations, and maintenance. Some of these opportunities include faster design, testing, and validation of reactor components and systems, reduction of costs using condition-based and predictive maintenance, improvement of operational efficiency while maintaining safety with real-time plant issue identification, diagnosis, and operational recommendations, and reduced staffing due to improved system control, increased awareness of plant state, and automation. Of joint interest to both licensees and the NRC is the potential for digital twins to improve the efficiency of regulatory processes while maintaining or even improving safety margins. A digital twin can provide a single trusted source of always up-to-date plant information, which could facilitate such things as a common platform for plant validation, verification, and uncertainty quantification, a shared framework for acceptance and approval of licensing actions, improved communication between licensees and the NRC, increased regulatory responsiveness by identifying safety certificate issues in real time, and improved inspection efficiency by enhancing NRC activities to prepare and gather information. Given these potential opportunities, interest in nuclear digital twin applications is understandable, and this interest has inspired the NRC's Digital Twin Future Focus Research Project, discussed next.
The NRC's Digital Twin Future Focus Research Project was developed to identify and evaluate the regulatory impacts of a nuclear digital twin system, such as technical issues and gaps, and the needed regulatory infrastructure. To that end, we have published several technical reports and information letters to help prepare the NRC for digital twin. We also held two widely attended workshops on digital twin applications. Here are some of the workshop participants. As you can see, there is a significant interest in digital twins among nuclear stakeholders, and the insights and activities discussed in the workshops have been captured in the two NRC information letters.
Good afternoon. My name is Candace, and I hope you're having a great experience here at the RIC. The team also researched various technical aspects of digital twins and published technical reports assessing the current state of digital twin technology, as well as the technical challenges and gaps for these enabling technologies. One of the things we have learned is that digital twin technology is rapidly evolving, and nuclear stakeholders are already beginning to implement it. To give you an idea, here are some applications discussed in the State of Technology report. As you can see, digital twin technology is already being applied to improve design, testing, validation, and operation and maintenance efficiency, including in several projects that are sponsored by the Department of Energy's ARPA-E Gemina program. For example, X-Energy is using an immersive digital twin environment during design to optimize plant operations and maintenance and identify where cost reductions can be safely achieved. Kairos is using digital twins for iterative development to directly reduce uncertainty and cost overruns. We have covered a lot of information in a short time, but if you would like to know more, both the technical reports and information letters are publicly available on the NRC website. This project has been a collaboration between the NRC and Idaho and Oak Ridge National Labs. We also coordinated closely with the Department of Energy's ARPA-E and the Electric Power Research Institute, or EPRI, to share information and co-sponsor workshops. While the future focus phase of this project will be completed soon, digital twin research continues. We will discuss continuing research later, but let's discuss what we've learned so far.
Hi, I am Vaibhav. One of the things our team identified early was the importance of certain technologies to the implementation of a nuclear digital twin. These enabling technologies are the key to the feasibility of digital twin and must be successfully developed, matured, and regulated. We identified the following enabling technologies. Advanced sensors. Now, advanced sensors will be required to measure and communicate the large volumes and new types of plant data required by the digital twin. These large volumes of heterogeneous data flowing from the plant will also require new analytic and information management. Analytic and information management is an enabling technology that's needed to capture, correct, categorize, integrate, protect, and process this data into useful forms. Machine learning and artificial intelligence. It'll be leveraged to characterize and model complex plant systems, as well as produce predictions, recommendations, and even plant control signals. Advanced and multiphysics models. Now, multiphysics models and advanced models will be needed to represent complex plant systems and processes, as well as their interaction in real time and with high fidelity. Finally, the key to maintaining concurrence with the physical plant is the use of data-informed models. Such models will use real-time plant data to update and correct their performance while running. Of course, challenges exist to the implementation of these enabling technologies, and they will be discussed next.
So far, we've presented an overview of digital twins, the opportunities for their use in nuclear, and some of the key enabling technologies. Now, we will move on to discuss challenges and gaps that exist for digital twin implementation. We've broadly categorized the challenges into three groups. Challenges with advanced sensors and instrumentation, challenges associated with modeling and simulation, and challenges associated with data and information management. The path to a nuclear power plant digital twin is one that will see a more fully instrumented plant and also introduces challenges with advanced sensors and instrumentation. There will be a greater number of sensors, including more varied sensors with new technology and even multimodal sensors. To feed the digital twin the data it needs, these sensors will supply real-time data to models and simulations. Other considerations include optimization of sensor selection and placement, infrastructure for real-time sensor data collection, and sensor maintenance. Modeling and simulation challenges arise from the complex and interdependent systems that form a nuclear power plant digital twin. The digital twin will integrate real-time heterogeneous data into similarly real-time heterogeneous physics-based and data-informed models. This further includes selections of machine learning models, scaling data analytics, computational efficiency, and quantification and propagation of uncertainty. The challenges related to data and information management encompasses both physical and procedural requirements for digital twin implementation. The specific nuclear power plant digital twin physical infrastructure requirements for data storage, data sharing, and computation are not yet well defined. Additionally, nuclear-specific standards and guidance are likely to develop regarding technologies like cybersecurity, redundancy, and encryption. The implementation of a digital twin will also see the transition from a document-centric approach to one that is data-centric. While digital twins offer great opportunities, additional effort is needed to meet the challenges of implementation and regulation.
Hi, I'm Doug, and it's my pleasure to wrap up this presentation. Let me start by summarizing some key project takeaways. As we've mentioned previously, there is substantial stakeholder interest in digital twins, and the technology is rapidly developing. Already, we have identified several likely nuclear use cases, such as maintenance optimization, real-time radiation mapping, and even use of digital twins to detect and diagnose plant issues. Also, this is my favorite one, a digital twin offers great promise as a novel source of real-time and trusted information. Information that can inform activities like plant design, testing, operations, and even regulation. Additionally, there is a growing need for collaboration to share information, develop common solutions, and establish a community of practice among nuclear digital twin stakeholders. Of course, actual implementation of digital twin will require advancements in several key enabling technologies. Some of the most significant among these are data-informed and real-time multi-physics modeling and simulation. And finally, while we are near the end of our future-focused research, the project's end is really only the beginning of the NRC's digital twin research. So what's next? The NRC is busy working on 3 new reports, and they'll be published soon, as well as the summary report for this project. The new reports will explore regulatory considerations and opportunities, advanced sensors and instruments, and the safeguards and security issues associated with digital twins. As this new research develops, the NRC will continue to identify and address significant digital twin regulatory issues. Our aim is to engage early and encourage discussion centered on common frameworks. In closing, while much work remains, our future-focused research will successfully conclude this spring. We hope to have started a lasting regulatory conversation aimed at preparing both the NRC and nuclear stakeholders for the coming digital twin world. Thank you for the opportunity to share our work, and have a great rest of your day.
Thanks, everybody. That was really a great video and slide. It really gave an excellent overview. And I think we were going to close the presentation here. I think Dr. Eilengar, he's the branch chief of our reactor engineering branch, wanted to close the presentation with a few words. Raj, and then we'll get to questions.
Sure. Thank you so much, Ray. And so the story of success goes in the Future Focus Research Program. So a couple of years ago, when we initiated this, before ARPA even funded the $40 million grants to several vendors and national labs, little did we think that the future is here and now. And here we are, and we are so glad that we started preparing for it early enough to underscore the very theme of this RIC. Thank you so much, and the staff had put in a lot of energy and enthusiasm, as you can see, into creating this successful program. We owe this to the vision of Ray Frostnell, because he was the one who conceived this. We did have a small seed, not a big one, not an acorn, a tiny one. And I think we have realized the vision of this program. And thank you so much.
Well, thanks, Raj. We do have time for one question here for you. How do we know that the digital twin is actually a twin? How do we know it's accurate enough to represent the plant and not missing any important subtleties?
That is an excellent question. And that's what we are hoping these enabling advancements in these enabling technologies will ensure. It is not, although the digital twin might be similar to a simulator, you can have many simulators, but it's not a twin. So in order to make that happen, we need to be able to capture real-time data. And that's where the data and analytics become important, using advanced sensors, and keep it concurrent with the real time. That's what some of our folks call it, state concurrence. It's a fancy terminology, but it just says that it's just real time. It's like looking myself or looking at yourself in a mirror. And that's exactly what we will do. And the growth of these advancement of enabling technologies will help the industry achieve that goal.
Okay, well, thanks, Raj. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have for questions right now on this. And so again, thanks to you and your team for this, the progress you made on this wonderful project. So thank you. Next, we're going to go to the next speaker to talk about the project he's leading on applying the licensing modernization project methodology on an operating reactor. Matt Hubberstone is a senior reliability and risk analyst in the Division of Risk Analysis in our Office of Research here at the NRC. He's the branch he's in uses risk assessments and insights to support a broad range of regulatory applications. And Dr. Hubberstone's experience includes work on advanced monitoring, diagnostics, and prognostics for advanced reactor designs. He also worked at Sandia National Labs in the Advanced Reactor Concepts Division while he was in school. Dr. Hubberstone received his bachelor's degree in engineering physics from New Mexico State University, a master's in statistics from the University of Tennessee, and a master's degree and PhD in nuclear engineering from the University of Tennessee. And with that, Matt, I'll turn it over to you to talk to us about the application of the LMP methodology to an operating reactor. Matt?
Great. Thank you, Ray. I'm waiting for the slides to pop up. Okay, so Spencer, are the slides going to pop up? Just a quick question. Oh, there it is. Okay, great. Just a little bit of a delay there. Great. Well, thanks, Ray. And hi, everyone. My name is Matt Hubberstone. I'm going to be talking about the licensing modernization project for operating reactors today. This is one of several future-focused research projects that were approved back in 2020. And before I get started, I definitely want to acknowledge Keith Compton and Trey Hathaway from the NRC and Kurt Bedros from Idaho National Labs for their support with this project. Next slide, please. So the overview of this project is really just looking for ways to leverage the NRC's level 3 PRA model results to look at how we can leverage the LMP methodology for light water reactors. So the LMP methodology is a licensing approach for non-light water reactors, and it's described in NEI 1804 and endorsed by the NRC's Regulatory Guide 1.233. The LMP approach uses risk metrics that come out of a level 3 PRA model. The NRC has been working on developing a level 3 PRA model for several years now, so we thought this was a great opportunity to use those results to test the methodology and see what kind of insights we can get out of it. When we first started this project, the level 3 model results that we had available were for internal events only, so we started with that. And now that's expanded to include external events and other model enhancements. So now we're starting to dig into that. And throughout this presentation today, I'll discuss some of the results from both of those. Next slide, please. So this project is a two-phase project. Phase one we wrapped up about a year ago, and that used those initial results out of the level 3 PRA model that was for internal events only. Now we're moving on to phase two, which is these enhanced level 3 PRA model results. And we're also digging deeper into some of the other aspects, such as how uncertainty impacts the results and things like that. Both phase one and phase two are part of the original scope of this project. But outside of that, we're also looking at ways that some of these tools and insights can help support the NRC and their future needs. So we've been having those discussions. Next slide, please. So there are several objectives behind this project. First, we wanted to look at the LMP's feasibility for light water reactors. And we wanted to do that by piloting the LMP using the NRC's level 3 PRA model results. While we are doing that, we want to identify any challenges that come up and any issues that we have with it. We also want to see if there are any new risk insights on light water reactors that we can pull from this. And then we're continuing to prioritize communication throughout this project by both sharing the progress and results with both internal and external stakeholders. Next slide, please. So the technical approach is pretty simple. On the left here, we have the NRC's level 3 PRA model, which has decades of severe accident research behind it and light water reactor operating experience. That's all baked into that modeling. And then on the right, we have the LMP methodology, which is this risk-informed performance-based approach for non-light water reactor licensing. We're trying to merge those two together and see what kind of insights fall out of it. Shown here in the middle is the LMP's frequency consequence curve. This is really the backbone of the LMP approach. And I have a slide later on where I'll go more into detail on how that's used. Next slide, please. So before we get into that though, I wanna discuss a little bit about the NRC's level 3 PRA modeling process. So this slide shows how the process starts with the level 1 PRA and progresses out to the level 3. The level 1 PRA is shown in red here, and that's the type of PRA model that both the NRC risk analyst and industry risk analysts are most familiar with. It starts with initiating events and progresses out to your different core damage states. So that resulted in about 50,000 cut sets, which were then fed into the level 2 portion of the model, which narrowed those down by plant damage states. And then that ultimately was turned into 16 different release categories. These 16 release categories were then fed into the level 3 portion of the model, where we modeled the release, dispersion, and consequences associated with those different accidents. Next slide, please. So the NRC analysts used the MLCOR accident consequence code system, the MAX code, to do the assessment for us, the level 3 portion. The MAX code is a powerful tool with lots of different capabilities. We used it to generate the dose at the exclusionary boundary, which is the risk metric that's used in the LMP. Next slide, please. So we have those 16 release categories that come out of the level 3 PRA model. And what we did is we broke them up into three separate groups. We took the 5 release categories with the largest doses and we put them in the orange group. We took the 5 release categories with the lowest doses and we put those in the blue group. And then we took the 6 release categories in the middle and we put them in the gray group. There's a couple reasons why we did this. One was it made the results easier to understand visually. And then the second reason is that the level 3 PRA model results are non-public, so we can't share those directly with you. So this was a great way that we could still get some of the insights out there and get some of the discussion going. Next slide, please. So there are several different ways you can look at the release categories and compare them. Again, the largest dose group is in orange, the low dose group is in blue, and the middle dose group is in gray. If you look at the pie chart in the middle of this slide here, this is the contribution of these different groups to the overall consequence. So the largest dose group, as expected, dominates with about 90%. If someone was to use this information to inform a review or determine where to focus their attention, they might ignore the low dose group because they say it doesn't even show up on this chart. It's less than 0.5% of the contribution to consequences. But then if you move over and look at the frequency contributions, you get a slightly different picture. You see that, well, the largest dose group, even though they dominate the consequences, you're much less likely to see one of those, you know, like 1% chance. So maybe we should focus our attention on the middle dose group and low dose group since they dominate the frequency contribution. So in reality, we want to take both the consequence and the frequency into account, and that's taking a risk-informed approach to it. A great tool to do this is the LMP's frequency consequence curve. Next slide, please. So here is the LMP's frequency consequence curve. On the y-axis is the frequency, on the x-axis is the dose at the exclusionary boundary. Going diagonally across this chart is the target line. So for non-light water reactors and reactor designers, their design objective is to push their accidents down towards the lower left. So they want to reduce the risk significance of their accident families. As those accidents get closer to the target line and get above it, they become more risk significant. And for us, that would be an indication that we should look at those a little closer. So the LMP uses this curve to help with selection of licensing basis events, safety classification of SSCs, and determination of defense in depth adequacy. So we're not using it in this project to do those three things since this is for an operating reactor technology, but we are using this powerful tool to see what kind of risk insights we can pull out and what we can learn on both the method and on light water reactors. Next slide, please. So when you take the phase one results, remember the phase one results are the level three PRA model results for internal events, and you put them onto the frequency consequence curve, you get this slide. These bubbles here represent where the different accident families within those groups fall on the chart. As you can see, all three of these groups have an edge of their bubble that gets close to the target line and an edge that's farther away. So if an engineer or analyst at the NRC wanted to use this to help focus their attention on the more risk significant accidents, they would find accidents in all three of these groups to look at. And then there's also accidents in all three of these groups that are farther away from the target line and aren't as risk significant. Next slide, please. So that was the phase one results. Then we got the phase two results, which are the level three PRA model results that include external events, credit for flex, things like that. And what we did is we took the results from phase two results and we compared them to the phase one results. And we saw that accidents or different release categories had different sensitivities to these changes. So there are certain accidents that were more sensitive to external events, so that would drive up some of their risk. There are other accidents that were more sensitive to credit for flex, and that would drive down the risk. And then there were several accidents that these changes did not have much of an impact on. Some examples of these type of accidents is if you look at a LOCA accident, that happens pretty quickly. And so credit for flex doesn't make very much of an impact because you don't have time to use your portable equipment. Where your loss of offsite power accidents and station blackout accidents, they have a lot more impact, or flex has a lot more impact on those accidents and can drive down the risk there. So out of the 16 different release categories, 8 of them saw their risk increase a little bit, 2 of them saw their risk go down a little bit, and 6 of them remained about the same. Next slide, please. So when you take those new results and you put them onto the frequency consequence curve, you get this figure here. Again, we have the original solid bubbles from phase one. Then when you put these new results in, you see that it stretches the bubbles out a little bit. So some of the accidents get a little bit closer to the target line and some get a little farther away. Again, these insights could be very useful for a reviewer or an engineer to be able to look at those accidents that are starting to get close to that target line so they could focus their attention there. Next slide, please. So in conclusion, the LMP methodology is a powerful tool and has the potential for use beyond the original intent and for light water reactors. Some of the insights that we're gaining through this project, we have hope that they'll be able to support our future non-light water reactor licensing reviews. And then these results confirm the NRC's current expectations on operating reactor safety profile. So nothing popped out while we were doing this that really surprised us on that. And then we're continuing to explore ways to leverage the LMP methods and tools to help support our future work. Next slide, please. So next steps, we're still working on phase two now. So we got the preliminary results that you saw here in these slides, but we're still digging into those a little bit more to understand them. We're wanting to look at some of the specific accident sequences to see how they change from phase one to phase two. And then we're wanting to understand the uncertainty impacts a little bit more. So we're still working on that. We're continuing to engage with NRC technical staff on future needs and looking for ways to leverage some of these tools and insights. And then we'll continue to prioritize communication both internally and externally to share the results from this project. That concludes my presentation. Thanks, Ray.
Right. Thank you, Matt. I appreciate your presentation. Good stuff. We do have time for a couple of questions. So the first one, Matt, how will the results from the Level 3 PRA project be expanded from one site to other sites in the fleet? It looks like a Level 3 PRA is rather an expensive proposition.
Yeah, so that's a very important point, right? Like, you can't just take your risk results from one plant and apply it to another. So that's one of the things we're looking at how we can leverage some of these insights to other plants, even though you, like you just said, you know, you can't just one plant for one plant. There can be quite a bit of differences there. So we have some proposals, some ways we're thinking about doing that, but we're not really in a place yet to share that, but we're still thinking through that, but great question.
Okay, thanks, Matt. I think one more question. As you were doing the Future Focus Research Project, were there when you were doing that? I mean, you probably went in with some thought of how the overlay on the LMP curve would appear. Were there any unexpected results or surprises to you?
So actually, a lot of the results kind of aligned with what our expectation was, which I guess it's a good thing, but you're always kind of expecting to find something surprising. You know, we didn't actually, a lot of the accidents that we expected to be more risk significant, like bypass events and things like that, kind of did bubble up to the top. So I think even though there were no surprises, I think that's definitely a great insight, you know, to kind of confirm some of our other projects we've done in the past that show the risk significance of the different accidents.
Great. Well, thanks, Matt. I think that's all the time we have for questions. But again, I really appreciate you presenting today on a really, to me, a very fascinating project. So thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we'll go to the third Future Focus Research Project. It's going to be presented by Stephanie Bush Goddard. It's called Drones and Virtual Reality Tools to Analyze Radiological Surveys in Decommissioning. Dr. Bush Goddard is a senior researcher in our Office of Nuclear Regulatory Research, and she provides leadership and project management to the Radiation Protection Computer Code Analysis and Maintenance Program. And she leads advanced reactor and future-focused research activities, of course, in this area. Stephanie's held numerous leadership positions at the agency, including chief of the Radiation Protection Branch, senior health physicist, and nuclear engineer. She has more than 30 plus years of professional and educational experience in the materials, waste, security, and reactor arenas, including a wide range of radiation protection and regulatory framework issues and performance assessment methods. Dr. Bush Goddard has a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering and holds a master's and PhD in environmental health science with a minor in health physics. She's an adjunct assistant professor at the University of Maryland and as a recipient of graduate level fellowships. With that, I'll turn it over to you, Stephanie, and we look forward to your presentation.
Thank you, Ray, and thank you for that introduction, and hello to everyone. Can everyone hear me? Okay, great. So as Ray said, my presentation is about unmanned vehicles for decommissioning, or UAV for short, but you'll probably hear me say drones in most of the presentation. But before I begin, I want to give a special thanks to Pacific Northwest National Laboratory for providing the drone, the testbed facility, the radiation sources, and numerous signatures for the drone flights to perform this work. And they did it in a very short period of time. Next slide, please. So, the agenda today starts off with highlighting the major regulations and guidance documents developed to decommission and release NRC sites. Then I'll go into the driver, which really is a proof of concept to compare humans and drones. The methodology is next, then pictures of the actual drone flight, which was only 4 months ago. I'll present some preliminary data and results and potential next steps. This will be followed by final thoughts and recommendations for the future. Next slide, please. So the major regulatory requirement is in 10 CFR Part 20 Subpart E. This regulation is called the Radiological Criteria for License Termination. And it states, among other things, that the total effective dose equivalent to an average member of the critical group should not exceed 25 millirem a year, and their radiation levels should be as low as reasonable achievable. And so the key guidance for demonstrating a facility or site meets this regulation is provided here. One of the guidance documents is New Reg 1575. It's the Multi-Agency Radiation Survey and Site Investigation Manual, or MARSIM. Another one is 1507. It's the minimum detectable concentration with typical survey for instruments for various contaminants and field conditions. And trust me, that is a mouthful. And the third one, New Reg 1757, is Consolidated Decommissioning Guidance. Now, these are major guidance documents, among others, that form the basis of our proof of concept, because a future goal is to incorporate drone usage into these guidance documents. Next slide, please. So before we start with the methodology, remember the driver is to do a simple proof of concept. So we're interested in three research questions. Did the observed UAV or drone path differ from the human path? And of course, if so, how much? Did the survey path deviation impact the survey results? And were radiological measurements from humans and drones significantly different? Next slide, please. So before we get into the results, let's talk a little bit about the drone. The drone is an Aurelia X6 hexacopter, of course, with six propellers, and can accommodate a payload of up to 24 pounds, with a range of 3 miles and a flight time of approximately 30 minutes. These specifications were very important when you are building the payload, which includes what you see here, the data logger, a radiation detector, and in this course, we had two digital radiation detectors, a LIDAR and a LIDAR system. I also want to point out that the customized 3D printing castings were used to attach the components securely in the figuration to maintain the center of gravity when flying. Next slide, please. So what you see here are the button or check sources used in the proof of concept were cobalt 60, cesium-137, and americium-241. The activities ranged from about 3.5 to 40 microcuries. These radionuclides represent some, but not all, the major radionuclides found at decommissioning sites. Furthermore, these check sources are not representative of residual radioactivity in soil, which would be ideal, but time and budget did not allow for that. And if you remember, this is a proof of concept. So it's really to distinguish between humans and drones, not necessarily between a point source and an area source. The flight path you see here has two parallel survey transects, one for radiological sources and of course, one for background. They were marked with lumber to provide a visual pathway for the human surveyor and for the drone pilot to follow. And the sources were randomly placed 6 meters apart on the lumber. Next slide, please. So a total of 12 radiological surveys were conducted. Four were conducted by humans, and 8 surveys were conducted by the UAV or drone. Of the 8 drone surveys, the 4 surveys with the best performance were analyzed further, and the surveys were environmental conditions, for example, wind, altered the flight, were excluded from further analysis. Also, each survey had a high or low altitude. The height in centimeters is shown here, and an average velocity of around 0.2 meters per second. As a result, there were 4 major scenarios analyzed. For example, scenario three is just the first drone survey compared to the second human survey. Next slide, please. Now, prior to conducting the radiological surveys, the drones went through a series of pre-survey airworthiness, if you will. And this was required both by PNNL and the Department of Energy. These tests included a center of gravity determination, which included adjusting attachments to the drone such that the weight of the components were equal around the center of gravity. Other tests were for vibrational and structural integrity. And the navigational systems evaluations were conducted with both a surrogate payload and without a payload. These were hot tests, a navigational test, and a low altitude test. Next slide, please. So the radiation detector and data loggers were characterized in an indoor lab facility. This included testing various functionalities, including, of course, but not limited to just testing the cables to detectors to ensure that they were working, testing the loggers to laptops. And these steps were repeated several times to establish the robustness of the detector and data logger. After the successful characterization in the indoor locations, field testing was conducted. Data was collected for a period of 15 minutes at each location using both detectors at 20 and 50 centimeters above the test ground. And the average background count rate in terms of TPMs at each location is presented in the table. This picture on your left, I think if you're looking at your screen, represents a drone flying to collect activity over the background flight path. Next slide, please. So to keep all instruments consistent between the drone and human surveys, a field survey cart was used for the human survey. This allowed the UAV to be placed on the cart so that the same instrumentation for measuring location, the GPS, could be used for all surveys. The cart was modified to include a adjustable cantilever to extend the detector and LIDAR over the survey area to present distances above the ground. This picture shows a modified cart used to mimic radiological survey techniques conducted by humans for comparison with the drone radiological surveys. Next slide, please. And this is just a close-up look configured with the radiation detector payload. You can see that at the time the photo was taken, an activity of 1.6 counts per minute, which is the typical background activity around this facility, was detected and can be seen on the data logger. Next slide, please. So let's move on with caution because the drone flights were in November, the analysis in December, and the report including data and results are in draft form at this time. Nevertheless, earlier in the presentation, I discussed the three main questions. Question one was, did observed drone paths differ from human paths? And if so, how much? This question addresses any deviation between the drone and human survey paths as a function of the GPS coordinates. This question was answered by estimating regression parameters, specifically the slope of a regression line. In this context, the slope of a path is defined as the upward movement along a path per 1 meter of lateral deviation. As a result, for all surveys, for a lateral movement of 1 meter, the upward movement along a path was between 11 and 12 meters. The path for scenario four had the greatest absolute slope difference of 1.9, while the path of scenario one had the smallest absolute slope difference of 0.36. But the takeaway is that the maximum difference between the human and the drone over a source location is around 4.5 centimeters. Next slide, please. Question two was, Did survey path deviations impact survey results? This question addresses any deviation between the drone and human survey path as a function of altitude. This question was quantitatively evaluated by examining the altitude data and to determine if the detector had the sensitivity to record reliable radiological measurements at the altitude for both the human and drone surveys. Based on the minimum detectable concentrations that were determined before the flight, the activity level measurements of some sources would be difficult to detect above 100 centimeters for this particular scenario. But overall, the survey path deviations were not statistically significant. I want to point out a correction to this slide. The velocity variation said that it's between 1.8 and 2.6 meters per second, but that should be 0.18 and 0.26 meters per second. And the target, if you recall, is 0.2, I'm sorry, the velocity is 0.2 meters per second. Excuse me. Question three was, were radiological measurements from human and drone surveys significantly different? This table here brings together questions one, two, and three to summarize and answer this question. If the drone and human surveys are the same, taking into account velocity, height, path difference, their statistical distributions will be statistically equivalent. For this project, an alpha error of 0.05 was selected for statistical testing, and a p-value less than this number results in the findings that the two distributions are statistically different. Because all p-values were greater than the alpha error, there are no significant differences in the drone and human surveys using this radiological detector. Next slide, please. Now, because we are still analyzing results, the conclusions are inconclusive at the moment. However, one limitation of the study was a limited scope and schedule that did not accommodate additional analysis for precision, accuracy, and reproducible data. Additionally, the background transects, background pathways were not analyzed in depth. Also, when you considered on a check source by check source basis, some of the drone and human path segments exceeded the GPS uncertainty. Nevertheless, the preliminary statistical analysis results indicates that drones and human paths are statistically equivalent. From these draft results, the detectors worked well, the equipment is commercially available to perform surveys, and the drone does have potential in decommissioning. Next slide, please. Okay, that was the overall conclusions. Can you go to the next slide? So recommendations for next steps. Recommendations for next steps, the next phase of this project includes optimizing the radiation detection instruments, surveying complicated terrain, including subsurfaces, considering other radionuclides found at decommissioning sites, such as strontium-90 and tritium, and addressing the impact of environmental conditions like wind and moisture. And we are looking at numerous ways to team up and collaborate with other future focus research. For example, the first project mentioned in this RIC session, Digital Twins, shows promise in decommissioning space. However, we are looking to expand the use of drones to reach beyond decommissioning, as we see promise in reactor operation applications, including unmanned radiation surveys, emergency response applications, security assessments, and a number of applications where humans are normally used. Next slide, please. Finally, I want to recognize the project team listed here. I want to give an extra shout out again to PNNL, who recruited a number of subject matter experts, including statisticians, aviation personnel, including a pilot, payload and safety specialists, health physicists, and a number of decommissioning specialists. I also want to thank Cynthia Barr and Bobby Eade in MNSS for being champions. The report on this flight and data analysis should be out in a few months. Thank you, and that is the end of my presentation.
All right, thank you, Stephanie. I think we have time for one quick question, Stephanie. In the work that you've been doing so far, do you think drone usage offers or can offer some accuracy benefits compared to human surveys?
So definitely some accuracy benefits, but you know, in our area, radiation protection, one of the big philosophies is ALARA, as low as reasonable achievable. And that means as low as reasonable to the human. So if we can substitute drones for humans, we are eliminating that radiation dose altogether. And I just think that's a big health benefit. Although doses, you know, we regulate the safe uses of all our facilities. So doses are low, but it's just a benefit because if we can put in drones, then we can eliminate the human. And as far as the statistical accuracy, equations have to put in some type of human sensitivity and some kind of human error. And I think if we can take that variable out, then we can really move toward a more accurate calculation, actually. Of a measure of radiological measurements. Hope that helps.
Yes. Yeah. Thanks, Stephanie. That's a good answer. I think we're going to have to close your presentation now and go on to the next one. But thanks so much. This seems like a really exciting and probably enjoyable project as well.
Yes, it does.
All right. Thanks.
Thank you.
So we'll go on to the fourth FFR project that we were going to highlight today. It's on the review of advanced manufacturing technologies, or AMTs, for fusion reactor material. And our speaker today will be Amy Hall, but she'll also be accompanied by Shah Malik for the question and answer sessions. Dr. Amy Hall is a senior materials engineer, again, in the Office of Nuclear Regulatory Research in the Division of Engineering. And most of her career was spent at Argonne National Laboratory with publications on nuclear power plant aging and license renewal, reactor materials, transportation of hazardous materials, advanced engineered materials and metals, fusion reactor materials, and high-level radioactive waste disposal. She holds a BS degree from Iowa State University and a PhD from Northwestern. And for Shah Malik, Shah is also a senior materials engineer in the Office of Nuclear Regulatory Research. And most of his career was spent at the NRC working on nuclear power plant aging and reactor materials and a reactor pressure vessel and primary system piping. He previously worked at the General Electric on high temperature materials structural integrity for jet engines. He holds a BS and MS from India and a PhD from the Ohio State University. So thanks for joining us, Amy and Sean. Amy, I'll turn the presentation over to you. Thanks.
Thank you, Ray. Developing materials and advanced manufacturing technologies is required to withstand the extreme environment of a fusion reactor. The U.S. National Academies considered this as one of the three main needs to establish the scientific and technical basis for a fusion pilot plant by the 2040s. The Nuclear Energy Innovation and Modernization Act, NEMA, requires NRC to develop a technology-inclusive regulatory framework that encourages greater technological innovation for advanced nuclear reactors, including fusion reactors. The just released NRC SECE 22008 documents the work that NRC is undertaking to address regulatory pathways for potential fusion energy systems. Slide 2, please. As shown in this slide, we focus on the nexus between advanced manufacturing technologies, known at NRC by their acronym AMTs, and fusion reactor materials, particularly for plasma-facing components, usually referred to as PFCs. The qualification of the materials and components that surround the plasma and are exposed to fusion or radiation is still a significant challenge. The United States is heavily invested in these PFC materials, but to date, no credible PFC engineering solution has been demonstrated to meet requirements for fusion power plants. The NRC staff have studied various AMTs for the present and soon to be licensed nuclear power plants and non-power facilities. The NRC needs to be prepared to review both the materials and AMTs proposed for license applications for fusion energy systems and ensure that the regulatory infrastructure would support understanding the viability of a specific application. Slide 3, please. There are three main fusion reactor approaches: magnetic confinement, magneto-inertial, and inertial fusion. Our main focus is magnetic confinement fusion energy systems, such as the International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, commonly known as ITER, and more generally, tokamaks. Different fusion energy systems will have different operating conditions and thus different values for heat load, radiation load, and temperature gradients. Those given here were postulated for ITER. As mentioned in the last bullet of this slide, PFC candidate materials included silicon carbide, molybdenum, niobium, tungsten, beryllium, and graphite. Slide 4, please. ITER is being built at Carderac, France, through an international partnerships. It is scheduled to start operations in 2025, although it won't be fueled with the power-producing isotope tritium until 2035. The ITER diverter region mentioned in the last bullet of the previous slide and shown in the right-hand schematic and further on the next slide also includes copper and stainless steel structure and heat removal tubing. Novel materials and AMTs offer a potentially transformational advance for fusion energy by improving fusion plasma and engineering subsystems. Development of capabilities to better address risks and challenges associated with these advances would enable NRC to have a better awareness of fusion reactor materials when reviewing applications for fusion energy systems. As an example of AMTs being considered for fusion reactor materials, Czech researchers are exploring cold spray deposition of thick tungsten and tungsten-based armor that could be produced directly on the first wall surface. Cold spray technology is an AMT option that NRC has been investigating recently with researchers from Pacific Northwest National Laboratory. The figure on the left is a schematic of a tokamak fusion reactor. For dimensional perspective of this schematic, the red central solenoid will be about 13 meters high in ITER. The figure on the right shows a cross-section of the ITER vacuum vessel and the plasma-facing components. Tungsten was a candidate to be applied in the lower part of the reactor vessel, the diverter region, while tungsten alloys were considered for the remaining surfaces of the first wall. In ITER, due to its unique physical properties, such as low plasma contamination, low fuel retention, beryllium has been chosen as the element to cover the first wall, as shown here. Slide 5, please. Every 2 years, the International Conference on Fusion Reactor Materials is held. This past October, a researcher from Japan gave an invited paper examining radiation damage in tungsten alloys, which must stand with very harsh conditions, and thus high thermal conductivity and good mechanical properties are needed. As mentioned earlier, tungsten is a plasma-facing material candidate because it has high melting temperature, high resistance to sputtering, and high thermal conductivity. This schematic illustrates the tokamak blanket, cooling channels in the first wall, and diverter block. The blanket depicted in the lower left is a modular component consisting of a shield block for neutron shielding and a plasma facing detachable first wall panel that directly faces the plasma and removes the plasma heat load. The purpose of the diverter is to extract the power coming from the conductive convective heat flux and radiation while maintaining the plasma purity. It needs to tolerate high heat loads as the main interfacing components between the plasma and material surfaces, while at the same time providing neutron shielding for the vacuum vessel and superconducting magnets in the vicinity of the diverter. Slide 6, please. Arranged in a circle at the bottom of the vacuum vessel, the diverter is made up of 54 cassette assemblies. Each one is formed from an actively cooled structural backbone, the cassette body, each weighing about 5 metric tons, in austenitic steel and copper alloy, and plasma-facing elements covered in tungsten tiles. The full-scale diverter dome assembly prototype, number 5 in this schematic, was delivered to ITER in December 2021. This followed a multi-year manufacturing, testing, and qualification program at the Fremov Institute. At the ITER site in France, it will enter the first diverter integration trials, where full-scale prototypes of all diverter components produced by Europe, Japan, and Russia will be assembled for the first time. Simulations by researchers at Purdue University indicate that there may still be challenges, including unexpected and significant heat loads and damage to sensitive components, other than the expected damage to the original diverter plate and first walls. Thus, we are looking at AMT alternatives and solutions for first wall or diverter regions. Slide 7, please. During the past 4 months, since the inception of this part-time project, we have been working to identify the technical challenges associated with novel advanced materials for fabricating components, especially plasma-facing components, in the context of NRC's current and evolving regulatory framework. As an example of codes and standards activities, we have participated in ASME Boiler and Pressure Vessel Section 3, Division 4, fusion-related meetings. We are reviewing the draft standard, ASME FE1-2022, Rules for Construction of Fusion Energy Devices. We attended the 6-day-long 20th International Conference of Fusion Reactor Materials and reported back information concerning the state of art for fusion reactor materials and specialized AMTs and challenges to their deployment. Since the ITER first plasma is scheduled for 2025, followed by progressive ramp-up of the machine, it would be good to review the ITER databases while still available online from different contributing countries to anticipate any safety challenges before startup. This materials and manufacturing safety review must be done as soon as possible, since some of the detailed information may no longer be available after 2025. Slide 8, please. We are reviewing ongoing research, such as that sponsored by DOE, addressing silicon carbide, bimetallic joints, and refractory metals. As an example of some of the exciting American work underway, the Advanced Research Projects Agency, ENERGY, ARPA-E, and DOE Fusion Energy Sciences have recently joined forces to prioritize R&D that helps establish viability of fusion-enabling technologies, including novel fusion materials and advanced manufacturing. As alluded to in the third bullet, an Oak Ridge team will fabricate tungsten plasma-facing components using electron beam powder bed fusion and use in-situ process monitoring for optimizing process structure relationships. Silicon carbide materials are promising candidates for functional components in fusion reactors. work is underway exploring different AM fabrication techniques, such as binder jetting. The second bullet alludes to work done at the Fremov Institute under ITER cooperation, presented last October at ICFRM20. Slide 9, please. Our key planned activities will be integrated and refined to also be complementary and supportive of work done elsewhere at NRC. As researchers, our primary focus is to identify the technical challenges for fusion reactor materials and to investigate applications of AMTs to potential materials selected for different components. We will prepare a technical assessment report which details the technical challenges and potential regulatory gaps related to using and licensing AMT fusion reactor materials for nuclear applications. Also of interest are upcoming public meetings. NRC hopes to have a fusion public meeting on March 23rd, 2022. The White House will have a two-hour summit on March 17 that will be live streamed at YouTube. Developing a bold decadal vision for commercial fusion energy. Slide 10, please. To summarize, Dr. Malik and I are investigating AMTs that may allow overcoming design restrictions and exploit new problem-solving strategies. Our focus is on exploring innovative materials and manufacturing technologies to meet material needs for fusion energy systems. A goal is to develop a gap analysis of material requirements versus risk in the context of NRC's current and evolving regulatory framework as needed. We want to close with words of inspiration from the White House. Fusion, the same reaction that powers the sun, has the potential to be a game-changing technology to help us achieve net zero by 2050, protect national security, and enhance U.S. technology leadership. Decades of public investment, rapid growth in private investment, and major recent scientific advances suggest that now is the time to quickly move towards demonstrating commercial fusion energy. As part of the Office of Nuclear Regulatory Research, we will help proactively provide the technical basis for technical flexibility for future commission direction on the appropriate approach for licensing and regulating specific fusion energy systems. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Amy. And we have time for just one quick question because we are a little bit behind, but maybe you and Shaw can take this question. Technological advances like high temperature superconducting magnets suggest that commercial fusion power plants are likely to be far smaller than ITER. Does NRC's analysis on this project apply equally to the smaller scale devices with smaller fuel requirements and smaller overall machines? Is different analysis required for these smaller devices?
I will defer that to Shaw, but since this project is just getting off the ground and since ITER is having problems, I really think it would behoove us to look more generally beyond ITER because that's very expensive. It's not going to be really functional till 2035, and it has inherent difficulties from my perspective. Shaw, maybe I'm speaking out of turn.
Yeah, I think that's correct. And there are some smaller companies, both in US and Canada and England, they are working on a smaller reactor, both for the magnetic fusion, inertial fusion, and magneto-inertial fusion. And let us see who wins the race, so to speak, comes up with a viable plant, a smaller plant. They will be smaller. And within this intervening period between 2020 through 2035 or something like that. There are companies in the US as well as Canada, they are very actively participating. And they are also including EPRI, our Electric Power Research Institute, which is an international organization of utilities. And they are cooperating along with that in that area.
All right. Well, thank you. And thank you both for an exciting project as we look ahead to new technologies. Thank you both.
Thank you very much.
Our final project is a zero trust paradigm for cybersecurity and new reactors. And the presentation is going to be by Anya Kim. And during the Q&A, Kim Lawson-Jenkins will also join the stage. Dr. Kim joined the NRC in 2020 as a computer scientist in the instrumentation controls and electrical engineering branch. Shortly after she joined us, she kickstarted several cybersecurity research projects, such as characterizing the attack surface of digital assets and nuclear power plants, investigating novel technology implementations in nuclear power plants, and developing a zero trust paradigm for the nuclear industry, I think, which we'll hear about here in a few minutes. Dr. Kim has 20 plus years of experience in cybersecurity. For 19 years, she was at the U.S. Naval Research Lab, working on research and development in cyber defenses technology for the Navy. Some of her work includes developing a cyber event prioritization algorithm for Navy defense systems, creating the NRL security ontology, and developing the security architecture for a vehicle tracking system. She holds a PhD in cybersecurity from George Washington University. And Kim Lawson-Jenkins is an information technology specialist in the cybersecurity branch in the Office of Nuclear Security and Incident Response. So it's good to see we have two offices working together on this. That's a good thing to do with these future-focused research projects. Kim's been with NRC since 2014, and prior to that, she worked 10 years as a computer scientist in the Center for High Assurance Computing Systems at the U.S. Naval Research Lab in Washington, D.C. Kim received her bachelor's degree in computer science from University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign and a master's in applied scientist degree in computer science from George Washington University here in Washington, D.C. So with that, Anya, I'll turn it over to you for the presentation.
Thank you, Ray, and good afternoon, everyone. Since we're short on time, I'm going to jump right in. Can we go to the next slide, please? Thank you. Okay, so first I would like to walk you through and give you a background on why we chose to look at zero trust for the nuclear industry. In fact, isn't this timing auspicious? Because if you've been paying attention, just over a month ago, the White House announced its zero trust architecture strategy for the federal government. So zero trust has been getting a lot of publicity, but there's still a lot of misunderstanding about what it is. So it's worthwhile to spend some time going over the concept. And then I'll finally present how we plan to apply zero trust to the nuclear industry, in particular for new and advanced reactors. Next slide, please. Okay, so let's look at the current state of the art first. Some of you may be familiar with this. For those of you who aren't, this picture shows a logical model of a cybersecurity architecture in use at nuclear power plants today, or at least a version of it. It's a flat network, and it's segmented by security levels. This perimeter-based defensive architecture includes five concentric cybersecurity defense levels. Each are separated by boundary devices such as firewalls or data diodes, and at each interface, the digital communications are monitored and restricted. Systems that require the greatest degree of security are located within the most secure levels, the innermost level of the defense architecture, which in this case would be levels 3 and 4. And this is typical of most networks today, whether it's IT or OT. So despite having access control applied or enforced at each security level, once you're inside that level, you're considered trusted. And so once you're in that level, moving through a network or security level is very easy, especially if you're an attacker. And in cybersecurity, that concept is called lateral movement. So lateral movement becomes easy. Could we move to the next slide, please? So is that current perimeter-based defensive architecture we just saw, is that successful? For the most part, yes, especially when you're talking about commercial U.S. nuclear power plants. So if you're a U.S. nuclear power plant licensee, go ahead, give yourself a pat on the back. However, whether you're a cybersecurity person or not, you've probably heard of Stuxnet. You've heard of maybe SolarWinds, and more recently, Log4j. Despite perimeter-based defenses similar to the one we just saw, those attacks and the associated malware have found ways to successfully penetrate that perimeter and cause damage, and sometimes remain undetected for a long period of time. So, you know, supply chain vulnerabilities, insider threats aside, one problem with this perimeter-based defense is that once the attacker gets inside, that lateral movement I just talked about gets much more easy. Okay, and then on top of that, we have new and advanced reactors that propose to use various technologies such as artificial intelligence, AI, wireless and remote operations. And by the way, I'd like to state for the record that the technologies depicted here are just examples of technologies that are proposed by the industry. And the fact that they're here is in no way, shape, or form an endorsement of these technologies for use. Okay. As I was saying, these new and advanced reactors are using these various technologies, and they do not fit neatly within the traditional physical security and regulatory framework. In fact, advanced reactors may rely less on physical security, putting more of an emphasis on the cybersecurity aspect. So given all this, new threats, new technologies, new reactor designs, what was once working for us may not work in the future. So we need a new way of thinking about security. Next slide, please. So obviously that new way that we're thinking of is zero trust. So then what is zero trust? Okay. First off, let's start with what it isn't. It isn't a solution. It isn't a product that you can buy. It's not a specific technology. It's not even a set of technologies. Okay? There's no one size fits all magic bullet that you can pull off the shelf and neatly tie up with a ribbon and use. Rather, zero trust is a strategy or a philosophy with a set of guiding principles, assertions, tenets, whatever you like to call them. Depending on organization you ask, they state their principles or tenets a little bit differently. But despite that, despite how they list or these guidelines or tenets, the underlying concept is the same. Okay, the zero trust model assumes that a breach is inevitable or it's already occurred. Okay. It's what I like to call the paranoia mindset, despite the unsavory connotations with the word paranoia. In fact, depending on which side of the fence you're on, it's either paranoia or you're facing reality. Okay. Regardless, when you assume your network is hostile, okay, and a breach is going to occur, you realize there's no safe area inside the perimeter. So what do? You won't implicitly trust anymore. Okay? Trust is always going to be explicitly granted and dynamic, okay, requiring every user, every device, every request, every data flow it be authenticated, authorized, and inspected for abnormal behavior or activity. Okay, let me stress that again. Trust, explicit, and dynamic. Okay. So even after that, even after access has been granted, that you only grant the least amount of privilege needed for them to get their job done. And that would limit the lateral movement that we talked about of the attacker. And at the same time, you continuously monitor the network to detect threats, look for anomalous or malicious activity. And this paranoid mindset, that's what zero trust is about. Okay. And how you plan to address this paranoia is a separate issue. Okay. So while buzzwords that you may have heard like multi-factor authentication, virtual LANs, micro-segmentation, they're technologies that support your zero trust strategy, but they are themselves are not zero trust. And just because you use them, it doesn't mean you implement zero trust. So my bank requires me to present my PIN and my ATM card when I attempt to check my balance. Okay. That's an example of multi-factor authentication because I'm using two things, a PIN and an ATM card, and sometimes even a driver's license. But does that mean the bank can claim they employ a zero trust security model? I don't think so. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is a diagram or a figure from the NIST Zero Trust Architecture document, and it depicts the logical components of a Zero Trust architecture. Obviously, not all architectures have to look like this, and I definitely won't go over all of these components here, but I wanted to relate these components to what we just talked about. Okay, so in the very bottom, you see there's a user who's using their device to access a resource. And in the middle, there's a policy enforcement point. So in Zero Trust, the policy enforcement point will enforce any access decisions that are made. And you can't even know the existence of a resource without going through this policy enforcement point. And remember, we said that with the paranoid mindset, again, we require every device, every user, every transaction, every flow has to be authenticated and authorized and inspected. So that's where the policy decision point above that comes in. The policy decision point is responsible for the ultimate decision to grant access or not to a resource given a subject. Against a dynamic policy, and it makes that decision based on a lot of information. Okay, and so the bunches, the eight squares on the side are potential sources of information that would be used to make this decision. For example, the CDM on the top left on your side would be the Continuous Diagnostics and Mitigation System that gathers and provides information about the enterprise asset's current state, like what kind of patches has been applied to an operating system, what kind of vulnerabilities exist on the system. Essentially, what we'd call the cybersecurity posture of that system would be maintained there, and the information would be sent. The policy decision point would also obtain information about newly discovered attacks or vulnerabilities from threat intelligence feeds that could be external to the network. And then the SIM on the low bottom right side, security information and event management system that collects and provides security-centric information in a uniform manner that the policy decision point can use. And also data access policies can be used to make least privilege assessments or determinations. So in other words, to make proper authorization decisions, you really need to know what you have, right? Through network visibility, asset identification, what their current state is, and then continuously monitor and log, support least privilege strategy, have threat detection, data analytics, et cetera. All of that is needed to determine whether in this current state with this particular request, you can grant the access or not. Next slide, please. So now we have a good idea of what Zero Trust is, I hope. And we know that the federal government is adopting it for its IT networks, but can we use this in the nuclear industry? So while we believe, Kim and I believe that the Zero Trust paradigm is a potential strategy or alternative that can be applied to protect reactors, particularly new and advanced reactors, there are issues that need to be researched, right? The characteristics of the nuclear industry and actually other industrial control systems as well need to be considered and reflected in any Zero Trust model that we adopt. In particular, the intersection of safety and security and how to maintain that needs to be considered. The Zero Trust assertions and concepts in an IT environment may not be applicable as is in the nuclear industry. So those are the things that we have to consider when we decide to apply this. And furthermore, if this paradigm does work for the nuclear industry and nuclear power plants, then to adopt this new paradigm, what do we need? We need applicable guidance, right? So this research will also provide the basis for any future guidance in this area, as well as performance criteria against which to measure from. Next slide, please. So like Ray said, this is a newly started future-focused research. We don't actually have any results. We're currently surveying the Zero Trust landscape. And obviously, most of the current body of work knowledge out there focuses on IT networks. So we're keeping that in mind as we do our investigations and identifying any challenges and gaps that may exist for our use. And based on that, We plan to develop a zero trust framework that's suitable for the nuclear industry, where we look at concepts, principles, implementation strategies, and so on. And we are running out of time. So I also want to mention that of the principles I mentioned earlier, there's one I stressed particularly, and that was the concept of explicit and dynamic trust. That one, unlike other ones such as least privilege or knowing what you have, continuous monitoring, is a little bit different. So Kim and I really wanted to look at that. And that one requires using multiple sources to compute a trust score based on your acceptable level of risk. And what we want to do is develop or look at what kind of data analytics are needed to compute that trust score, what kind of data, how to collect it, how to measure it and combine it, and so on and so forth. Next slide, please. So this picture, I just wanted to show you where that trust algorithm, the component is usually called a trust engine, belongs. So while I imply that all this information is goes into the policy decision point, it actually goes into that trust algorithm that takes all this information to compute the trust score, and then that, along with the request, is what the policy decision point would use to make decisions. Next slide, please. And the expected results and benefits are that we hope that this would form the basis for any future regulatory guidance documents and provide an alternative way to have as a defensive architecture when applied to new reactors. And also, what we learned here would be useful for any industrial control system domain or safety critical industry in general, as well as providing like a common ground for discussion among staff, licensees, applicants, and vendors and inspectors regarding the zero trust paradigm. Next slide, please. So thank you very much. If you have any questions, please.
Thank you, Anya. I do have some good questions coming in. I know we're past time, but I think it's, if everybody can stick around for just a few more minutes, I would like to ask you guys some questions. And the first question is, what are your thoughts on distributed ledger technology and quantum communications? Can these be applied?
It's probably going to be, this is Kim Lawson Jenkins, one of the technologies that we'll possibly be looking at in the future as a way of implementing these things. It is not something that's currently covered in, unlike a lot of the controls that are normally used, those specific things about blockchain, for instance, those kind of things aren't mentioned in cybersecurity plans. Okay. So that will probably require some new guidance that's outside of the current set of security controls we're using. Okay. But that will probably be one of the things we'll be looking at for the future. Okay, there's new Part 53 work that's going on right now, and that no doubt will probably be part of the things that one of the controls, or a set of controls that they'll be looking at in the future guidance.
Okay. Kim, one more question before we close the session, because it's a really interesting topic. The zero trust concept is interesting, but does this introduce a single point of vulnerability on the architecture if the policy enforcement point is compromised? How would the NRC regulate such an approach? So who would like to take that question?
I don't think it's going to be an issue if the policy decision point is compromised, because there, for better or worse, there are going to be multiple ways of getting into a system, just as you have today. So it's really in the end the decision point that's going to be making the decision on how you're going to enforce the policy. So I honestly can't see a single point of failure, because this is going to be more of a philosophy and a strategy rather than a device. As Anya said, this is not a device that's going to be installed, that's going to do everything. So I don't think a single point of failure that will be applicable for this type of architecture.
Okay. Anya, could I add to that just a little bit? Do we have time?
Sure.
Okay, so yeah, so the picture was just a logical picture when we were looking at the NIST picture, but it's very simple. I didn't go into detail, but there's a data plane and a control plane, and it's very similar to software-defined networks. So I think the person who asked the question is probably familiar with that because that's how it's divided. And in software-defined networks, there is that single point of failure that goes where, and there are many attacks that where they try to take out that the control plane device. On top, in our case, it would be the policy decision point. But there are ways architecturally to get around it. You have multiple policy enforcement points, and you have redundant and resilient policy decision points. I mean, that's just one way. So what Kim said, totally, because, you know, it's not an actual device. We don't even know if it's going to look this way. This is just conceptual. But even if it were to look this way, there are ways to get around those kinds of vulnerabilities. But it's great that you pointed that out.
Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you, Kim and Anya. And I'd like to thank all the presenters. And I wish we would have more time for Q's and A's. We could go on for at least another hour yet, but I think we really do need to close the session since I'll get into trouble if we don't. So again, thanks everybody. And thanks for all of you who signed up and participated and asked questions today. It was a really fascinating, exciting, and enjoyable session, I know, for me. So thanks again, everybody. And with that, I'll close the session. Thank you.